Thank you for this kind introduction. It's a real pleasure to be with you today here in San Diego, California, because I think what is going on right now worldwide is very interesting, and I think what is going on in California especially is very important for what we are talking about. I'm very grateful that Charlie Gay, and I know Charlie since how many decades, I can hardly remember, has already set the stage very well, and I think what I will talk about will very well complement what we just heard, going a little bit more in the technologies of what we are talking about. So let me see, how do I get this? Ah, here, okay, was too lazy. You have seen the slides, Charlie, I just have to tell you, this is not from Martin Green, this is from Tony Seba from Stanford, who calls himself the chief disruptor. And Tony pointed out what we just saw from Charlie Gay, that it was unexpected and unforeseeable by all the experts in the year 1900 that in just 10 years you would have such a complete disruption of a very well-established system. I remember that somebody said that, you know, we won't have enough people to walk in front of the cars and wave with a red flag in order to really make sure that the traffic stays safe. But what we are really not aware of, and I think 80-90% of you here in the room the same, is today in the year 2017, when we are really so happy about having 270,000 jobs in renewable energies in the United States and million jobs worldwide, we are just at the very beginning of the solar century which is coming. We are just in the same situation as New York City in 1900 or 1910, and we will see the big disruptive development in the coming years. And we are on a way, on a good job. We have seen many figures from US. You will excuse me that I show some figures from Germany, but both really tell the same story. In Germany, we had in 1990 just 3% of our electricity from renewables, and there were advertisements in the newspaper saying more than 5% coming from renewables, from fluctuating sources like solar and wind, will lead to a complete breakdown of the grid. So it was incomprehensible that more than 5% of solar could be fed in the grid. Today, the latest number is actually not 30%, but 35%. We have installed more than 40 gigawatts wind, more than 40 gigawatts of PV, so the huge United States is on a good track to surpass the number of installed PV gigawatts in a very short time. But of course, it is very nice that we have reached this point. And the decisive point, and I don't want to go into the details, was a very unintended Chinese-German collaboration. You know, in 2006, 2007, the Chinese government decided that photovoltaics is of very strategic interest for the country. In 2002, 2003, the German government, which was at that time led by a left-green coalition, decided that we need to do something to bring photovoltaics out of the hole of much too high costs, which will never make it economically. And the really, really inventive idea was to use capitalism, to use the interest of investors to bring photovoltaics where it is today. So this was achieved by the instrument of the feed-in tariff. Anybody who bought a solar system could know that for each kilowatt hour, he or she got a certain amount of money, which at the beginning was 50 cents per kilowatt hour. It was unheard of. You know, the electricity rate at that time was about 10 cents, but if you could feed in solar electricity into the grid, you got 50 cents. And of course, this meant anybody investing in PV in Germany between 2000 and 2015 could make profits between 8 and 15% annually guaranteed for 20 years. So it was a really, really good method to stimulate private capital to bring about this development, which we see here. The only problem was Germany did not think about doing something for photovoltaic industry. The Chinese said, oh, the German market is a very interesting market. Let's give money to companies who want to build photovoltaics. So the Chinese government with the 11th five-year plan 2008 set aside $50 billion. Companies who wanted to build a gigawatt factory could easily get $1 billion of credit guarantee. This was not a subsidy, it was just a credit guarantee, and most of these credit guarantees were never paid out. So this was money the state never had to spend, because the companies at that time could make nice profits and pay back the credits. And with this, the Chinese built a gigantic PV industry. I will come back to this point later. So this German-Chinese interaction resulted to where we are today. And where we are today, and we have seen this curve already actually in two different forms in Charlie's presentation, is we have been able to really come down the experience curve. And the key information from this experience curve, from the cost learning curve, is the horizontal axis is not time. It did not come down because we waited 10 years longer till technology was getting better, till prices came down. No, the horizontal axis is deployed volume. So by this very innovative market incentivation, it was possible to come from the megawatt scale to the gigawatt scale, to come from prices of more than $10 per watt for the modules to today's 40 cents, 30 cents per watt, which is the latest on the market today. So this was really what brought photovoltaics into the range where it is now really absolutely competitive, and in most cases even much lower priced electricity than from conventional sources. At my institute in Freiburg, we as well tried to predict where prices of photovoltaic electricity would develop, and we estimated, and this is not so long ago, this is a study from 2014, that 2050 we might be between 2 and 4 cents per kilowatt hour. In Dubai in 2016, a large PV installation was auctioned off with the price power purchase agreement. So this is not the cost of solar electricity. This is a price where some investors still expect to make profits by selling solar electricity for 2.4 cents per kilowatt hour. Of course, Dubai has a very favorable sunshine condition, but southern areas of the United States come close to this. So basically, this could be the same situation there. So even people like Charlie and myself, when we talked about this 5 years ago, 10 years ago, we did not dream that this would happen so short, so quickly, and I think it is a fantastic achievement for all of us. Let's talk a moment about technology. I have been here in the United States since 1986, and I really witnessed the different fights for technologies. Everybody said, including the energy secretary, Steve Chu, that crystalline silicon technology will be only the technology of the first generation. We will have second generation thin films, we will have third generations organic nanostructured PV, which will be much less expensive. You can paint it on the wall and collect electricity. It's all nonsense. It's crystalline silicon today, and I guess it will be crystalline silicon for quite some time to go. 90% of the market share is crystalline silicon, and the two ways to do it, as a single crystal where you cut wafers, or as a multicrystalline silicon where you basically solidify silicon in a big container and you have to cut the wafers vertical to the growth direction so that the grains go from the top side to the bottom side, and with this you can make almost as good solar cells as with single crystal. Thin film is still existing, a 10% market share, mainly due to the fact there is one company, First Solar, who has been able to commercialize cadmium telluride thin film technology, not because they can sell the modules in a competitive way in the market, but because they were smart enough to use money from their IPO to sell electricity. So they build electric solar parks, sell electricity, and this they can stay there where they are in the marketplace. A very important message which I would like to convey with you is crystalline silicon technology is still a very active field of research and development. At the moment, 90% of the world market uses the very simple so-called aluminum back surface field, ALBSF technology, where you simply take a piece of P-type silicon, you diffuse phosphorus from the front side, you plate the backside with aluminum for the backside contact, and you apply on the top anti-reflection coating and a thin film, thin grit fingers for the front side contacts. And this is a very simple technology which makes 90% of the market. However, we can do much better. We can use, for instance, the PERC technology. I will show you in a moment. We can use metal wraps through interdigitized base junction and then finally heterojunction technology to increase the solar cell efficiency at ever reduced production costs. As a matter of fact, the message is crystalline silicon PV is by far not yet a commodity. It is a high-tech product where very active technology development goes along as we speak right here. Here you see how it works. Let me take you through the top left technology because it's very easy to understand. In the standard silicon technology, the backside is a layer of aluminum. And anybody who has done semiconductor physics knows that a metal semiconductor contact is a very good place for carrier recombination because minority carriers are attracted there and can recombine. So we do have a very convenient and cheap backside contact, but we lose efficiency because of carrier recombination. So it is much smarter to passivate the backside by a layer of silicon dioxide or sapphire aluminum oxide and only to set individual contact points. Today we can use a laser to set 10,000 contact points per second. You see here this individual contact points, and the advantage is the whole backside is very well passivated, no carrier recombination, and you still have a good contact to bring the carriers out. So PERC technology allows us to go from the 18 to 20% efficiency range of the current old style technology to the 20 to 22% efficiency range. Then come other technologies as shown here, metal wrap through heterojunction. This holds the current world record of 26.6% conversion efficiency. However, heterojunction technology still has to be made cost effectively to make it to the market. PERC technology is right now transitioning into the market on a large scale. So you will see further developments of PV technology in order to bring efficiencies up and costs down, because efficiency is really very key in the final cost, because efficiency means for a given area you get more power, and of course efficiency goes into all the calculations because you have inverters and other elements independent of the efficiency. So the higher the efficiency is, the lower is the cost of the photoelectricity. I would to show you one scheme of a novel type of silicon solar cell developed at our institute, which we call TOPCon technology, and which is a very interesting attempt. In order to contact the backside layer, we don't use contacts, we use an insulating area. And you would say, this is crazy. An insulator cannot be a contact. And it is absolutely true. But if you make the insulator thin enough, you get what is called the tunneling effect. And carriers can tunnel through a layer which is just 1 nanometer, 2 nanometer most, couple of angstroms thin. And today, luckily, we have deposition techniques which can able to, which allow us, for instance, in atomic layer deposition, to deposit on large areas in a controlled way, very thin oxide. And with this technology, we can make in a very competitive process, this means with low cost technology, 25% solar cells. Very interesting, not yet in the market, but very interesting. And another comment which I want to mark, just a couple of months ago, we were able to come through the glass ceiling of the crystalline silicon solar cell efficiency, because all textbooks tell you that silicon can never make a solar cell with more than 29% efficiency, the so-called Schottky-Quaiser limit. And of course, this limit is a physical limit. We cannot do anything about it. But if we combine a silicon solar cell with a 3-5 cell on top of it, we have found a structure which is a two-terminal device, contact on the top, contact on the bottom. Most of it is crystalline silicon, but with wafer bonding, a 3-5 layer is attached, and we were able to come through the glass ceiling 30.2% efficiency. This might not be the technology of the future. My personally, at the moment, most exciting development is to do the same thing, but with another less expensive structure with perovskites. If we are able to put perovskites on top of a good crystalline silicon solar cell, we should be able to move from 30% to 35% and higher in efficiency. However, of course, also one short pitch here in between, another very interesting technology which came out of my institute, and therefore I want to share with you these three slides, is the possibility to make single crystal wafers without the enormous losses which you have in cutting. Because if you cut a single crystal and you want to make wafers with a thickness of 100, 150 microns, half of the material goes into the kerf loss because the wire cuts through the material and you cannot make wires much thinner than about 100 microns. However, if you could make single crystal wafers without the kerf loss, you would cut the loss of silicon, and silicon is a very expensive material because we purify it very much in half. And the idea here is to use porosification of silicon to make on top of a silicon crystal a porous layer, which is something like Swiss cheese, to overgrow it epitaxially, as it is shown right here. And then the epitaxially grown layer can be lifted off from the substrate very easily with a small thermal shock. Sometimes it just pops off by itself. And the end is you have a monocrystalline epi wafer, which you can use just like a wafer cut from a wire saw, and you can reuse the substrate to make the next type of wafer. And as a matter of fact that it works, you see here I have one of these lifted off large wafers in my hands. So it really, really is an interesting development, and our startup company NextWave will be a very interesting future, I'm sure. But what can we do when we want to go really much higher in efficiency? We have to do more intelligent photon management, because with a single semiconductor, the efficiency, and I told you already about the Schottky-Kreiser limit of 29%, it is limited because on the one hand side, everything which has a photon energy below the band gap, it's transmitted. Photons which have the band gap right at the band edge are actually absorbed with 100% quantum efficiency. So you can make solar cells with 70-80% efficiency for one individual wavelength. And this is actually done as well technology to transmit power by light. It is possible. But in a solar spectrum, now you have lots of photons with higher photon energy, and they have to thermalize the carriers which you produce, because at the end you can only harvest the bandgap energy. So you lose by transmission, you lose by thermalization, and the result is this Schottky-Kreiser limit. If we want to go higher, we have to use more bandgaps. As I already showed you, this one result from the 3-5 on silicon cell, which was produced by wafer bonding, the theoretical estimation for multi-junction concentrator cells is about 60-65%. One concrete example is to use a germanium substrate. So germanium has a small band gap and covers well the infrared part, and then use 3-5 layers on top of it, like gallium indium arsenide, gallium indium phosphide. And this looks like here. It is a very costly, very complicated structure, because you do not need only the three materials. Each material has to be done in N and P type, just like in a laser. A solar cell is like an inverted laser. You need to have recombination layers, tunnel junctions in between, so that the current goes through the whole structure. You have to carefully match the current of all the different layers, because if you have one layer which would make a bigger current, it doesn't go through the other layers. So it is a very interesting design issue. But at the end of the day, you can reach very high efficiencies. These type of cells are being used for space applications, because if you want to power a satellite, you don't ask how many dollars do you have per watt. You ask how many kilogram of payload do you need to bring a certain power up into space? So there the cost doesn't play the role. But you can use it on Earth in a concentrator solar cell where you cut out of a wafer hundreds of small solar cells, like here 2 by 2 square millimeter, put them under a concentrating lens, and you concentrate the light of the large area on the small solar cell. And as a matter of fact, now you have the whole possibilities of 3-5 technologies, including lift-off technologies, including wafer bonding technologies, because you cut so many solar cells out of one wafer. And with a structure which used an indium phosphide layer in between, we were able to achieve the current absolute world record of the conversion of solar light to electricity of 46%, as you see it here. The problem is these type of concentrator solar cells are still not as competitive as a price reduction in the silicon market. So at the moment, we don't have a big producer of this technology. The question is really, it is a chicken egg problem. Can one quickly enough come to scale in order to match what's going on in silicon? But looking at this efficiency table, which is established regularly by NREL, I want to point your attention to a very important recent development. And these are these yellow dots which you see here. This is the development of perovskite solar cells. If you see conventional crystalline silicon and thin film technologies, very long development times, many, many years with very small changes of efficiencies, perovskites have made an enormous development in just a few years and are now at 22% efficiency, which is not a value which you can make modules of. It is a small area, but it is interesting. My personal opinion is that perovskites solar modules making gigawatts of power will probably not appear because there is a big competition of the silicon market and the big power of this market. However, if we are managing to bring perovskites on silicon in a cost-effective way and to create silicon solar cells with 35% and more efficiency, this is something which can be very realistic. And I think in many places of the world, we have very exciting developments going on in this direction. So you have already seen what happened in the market, so I can be very brief. The global PV market evolution was not interrupted by things like the big economic crisis of 2009. It continuously increased. Here you don't see what happened with the companies who were behind this. You know about the problems in the last couple of years, but you see the market continued to increase. As a matter of fact, if you look at added capacity, you can see the renewable energy capacity added worldwide in 2016 was mainly dominated by solar. 70 gigawatt of new installations of solar, which even put wind with about 50 gigawatt at second place. Altogether, of course, we are happy about all renewable energy being deployed. And you have seen a different form of this curve, but the nice feature of this curve, which I show you here, it is a graph from November 2010, Stone Age of PV. And in November 2010, Sarrazin Bank dared to predict that in 2020, the world market of PV might reach 100 gigawatt. As a matter of fact, each year the world market exceeded the predictions of Sarrazin, and I was very pleased, Charlie, that in your very detailed analysis, you come for 2020 to something like 97 gigawatt as a world market. So the 100 gigawatt world market in 2020, maybe 120 gigawatt world market in 2025. So in 5 years, doubling of the current world market is what everybody is predicting. And this means really that we have a very exciting times in front of us. The last 8 years were characterized by a very difficult situation in PV because whereas the growth of the world market was steady and very interesting, the production capacity for PV, especially which was installed in China in 2008 till 2012, was installed so quickly that in 2012 you had basically double the production capacity available compared to the size of the world market. And this was the reason for this very difficult situation. You had a huge overproduction. Companies were desperate, selling off modules at prices below their production cost. I was on the board of Qcells in 2013, and we had 100 megawatt of modules in stock. And these modules cost about $1.10 per watt in production, but the market price was down to 90 cents. And we said from the board, go ahead and sell it, because it was still valuable cash, although it was sold at a loss. But of course, under such situation, companies go into insolvency. You know, takeovers happened. And of course, companies which had the deepest pockets, and pockets, of course, helped by government programs like in China, were very helpful to take over the industry. However, today, the overcapacity has been decreased substantially. It is not completely gone. We still have overcapacity today, so there is still pressure on the price. But if we now look forward till 2020, 2025, we have to double the global PV production capacity. So there is a fantastic opportunity for countries who are not yet in this game to take part in this doubling of the global PV capacity. To say it once more, in 10 years, we have built up the first 60 gigawatt of PV production. In the next 5 years, we will build up another 60 gigawatt of PV production capacity. So it will be quite exciting times. In March 2016, we convened a workshop from the Alliance of Solar Energy Research Institutes with NREL, AIST in Japan, and Fraunhofer ISE. I think Sarah, yes, she is over there. She was one of the key people bringing this workshop together. And this workshop was then summarized in a paper which we published in Science in spring of this year. And our conclusion is, in 2030, we look at a market which can have an installed PV capacity between 3 and 5 terawatt, 3 and 5 thousand gigawatt of power. And this compared to today's situation. Let's have a look at this curve, which is very similar to one of the graphs Charlie showed, but this is from the International Energy Agency, and they already predicted, yes, we go into the terawatt range. IEA thought the terawatt range would come in 2050, we say this can be already in 2030. But the most important information from this graph is, today we need a magnifying glass on this graph to see where we are. We have 300 gigawatt installed, so we are just at the beginning of the global growth curve. This is the same message which I showed and Charlie showed at the beginning. We are just at the beginning. The real big growth of the PV industry will happen in the years to come. You might get nervous and say, how can we accommodate such amounts of fluctuating electricity? How can we get a stable and secure electricity supply out of wind and solar? And we took the task in my institute to make a very detailed model using Germany as an example, looking at electricity, looking at fuels, at heat, at the whole energy sector, including the mobility sector, including industry. And the model included all these different players, different ways of providing renewable and conventional energy. And we used the data of the years 2011 to 2013, and we made an hourly analysis from today till the year 2050, hour by hour, how can we secure the energy supply of Germany with renewables. And the result was, we can do it. And the financially sweet spot is not to go so quickly to 100% renewables, but to go to 80% renewables. And you do it 80% renewables, the energy system will be at the same cost as today's system, only that the cost does not longer go into fuel, it goes into maintenance. But the important message is, what we need exceeds the expectations of most people. Germany has an electricity system which has a peak power need of 80 gigawatts. The model shows, to make the secure energy supply, you need to install 150, so about double the peak need in photovoltaics, and again 150 gigawatts in wind, together with all other measures which are shown here. You have to have as well storage, and the size of the storage systems could be analyzed from this. But this means when you have 300 gigawatts of solar and wind installed and only 80 gigawatts of peak power needs, there will be times of enormous amounts of surplus electricity power. So power to gas, power to chemistry, hydrogen generation, hydrogen provision for electric mobility, for fuel cell cars, this will be all part of the future energy system. And we even calculated the cost, and the cost is actually quite expensive. Till the year 2050, 5,000 billion euros. But the energy system, the business as usual case, would be 4,000 billion euros. So the difference between going to the cost-effective way in renewables, where we have 5,000, and the business as usual, where we have to spend 4,000, is just $1,000 billion, 30 billions a year, which is a very small amount compared to the whole economy. So the transformation of the energy system for a country like Germany is cost-effective, it is possible, doable, can be done. And my final point is, what happens with the grid stability? Because the grid cannot take more than 5% fluctuating renewables, as we were told in 2006. And I must tell you, for 2006, the statement was as well correct. Yes, the grid of 2006 in Germany would have been completely broken down if it had already the 25, today 35% of renewables. But what happened is the following. This red curve gives you the statistic average interruption duration index, which is called SAIDI. And this index in Germany was 22 minutes of average interruption per person in Germany in 2006. And it went down, it was cut in half. So in today's grid in Germany, we are at 12 minutes of interruption. And the reason is that we had to strengthen the grid substantially. In 2006, the grid was operated by hand. If there was some problem, then you had to take a telephone to get power from somebody. Today, our grid is completely automated. That means hundreds of grid net nodes act independently, very intelligent behind it. Of course, weather predictions, all of the things which Charlie mentioned are part of this. But the grid, which is enforced to take care for fluctuating renewables, is a more resilient grid than the grid which is based on thermal power plants running 24 hours a day. And of course, if you look at these numbers here, sorry, I must get rid of that. In France, with 80% nuclear power, the SAIDI index is 68 minutes. In the UK, it's 55 minutes. In California, it's 150 minutes. So the final message which I want to convey, the transformation of the energy system is the best thing you can do to an energy system, because it forces the grid provider to update their grid to this automatic operation, which allows to get a stable electricity supply with fluctuating input. And therefore, it is good news for industry, it's good news for the consumers, and it is the right way to go. So PV will be moving into the terawatt age. It already today has become a cost-effective source of electricity, and the lowest prices really beat all other ways to make electricity. We expect the cost to decrease further. Today in Germany, like in the northern part of the United States, you have 6 to 7 cents a kilowatt hour. We want to have, of course, 2 to 4 cents per kilowatt hour, even in those locations. It means we need further technology advancements. We need the cost of storage to come down. The keyword Tesla and Musk has already been mentioned. And we need the right financial and regulatory environment. In 2016, we announced that PV is now entering the terawatt region, and I think this is an absolute, very likely scenario. And the final message is, yes, at the end of the day, we will have a stable, a cost-effective energy supply system for hundreds of years to come, and we will not have to exhaust our fossil sources, and we will not have to spoil our atmosphere through too much CO2 emissions. So let's do it. Let's do it as fast as possible. Thank you so much.